So this is our work on lifted marginal map inference. This is joint work with Vishal, Noman, and Happy, who are students with me and Vibhav at UT Dallas. So let me get started. Okay, so here is some motivation for the work that I'm going to present. So a lot of real-world applications are characterized by uncertainty and relations. For example, think about NLP, computer vision, social network analysis. You have entities and relationships between them. And you have also uncertainty that you want to model using well-founded probabilistic models. Statistical relational models have been around for about a decade, and they can actually handle both these aspects. They can handle uncertainty very well using statistical models like probabilistic graphical models. They can also handle relations using something like first order logic. And that will be sort of the basic framework which we, with which we'll work in this talk. So given this, one of the important tasks that you care about is the task of reasoning or inference. One of the standard ways to reason in these models is, or one of the naive ways rather, is to simply take your model, ground it, get the propositional model, and then you can apply standard inference techniques, but this can be suboptimal, in particular because you don't exploit the structure that is present in the network in the logical language. Lifted inference, which has been around for, again, for about a decade, looks at exploiting this structure for making inference efficient, and this can lead to significant computational gains, especially in terms of time. There is a lot of work in lifted inference, which talks about lifting marginal inference and also map inference, but unfortunately, there is no prior work, to the best of our knowledge, which looks at a lifted marginal map inference. So by marginal map, I mean the problems where there are latent variables. You need to sum over those latent variables and then maximize over the remaining variables. So this is the task that we'll look at in this paper. So before I go to the meat of the talk, let me sort of briefly say the contributions of this work. There are three broad contributions. The first one is more technical, that we define something called an extrema property. Intuitively, this is the property that will show in certain cases, the ground atoms of our theory, will all of them will either have true or false assignments, and this is what we call as extrema property. And we will use this property to come up with a rule for lifting marginal map inference. Then we also give an algorithm for applying this rule along with existing rules. Unfortunately, I may not be able to talk about it in the presentation, but I'll encourage you to look at the paper if you're interested. And finally, I'll show some experiments which show significant computational gains compared to existing approaches. So here is a brief outline of the talk. I already gave you some motivation. I'll describe some background on statistical relational models, in particular Markov logic. I'll describe the two main contributions, which is exploiting the extrema property and also lifting rule for marginal map inference. I'll describe experiments and conclude with directions for future work. Okay. So here is sort of one or a couple of slide summary on Markov logic. I believe many of you might be familiar with it, but let me just describe it for completeness. So Markov logic networks were proposed back in 2006 by Richardson and Domingos. And the basic idea is to make your first order logic theory softer. So it's a pair of Fi and Wi. Fi is a formula in first order logic, finite first order logic. Wi is a real valued number. And given a Markov logic theory and a set of constraints, it results into a ground Markov network where there is a node for every ground atom and there is a feature for every ground formula. This is an example that we'll use throughout this talk. This is the running example. So there are two rules here. Each one has a weight. So the first formula says that friends xy and parent zx implies no zy. So it is simply saying that you are likely to know the friends of your children, right? So there is a weight, which means that this formula is not always true, but you know, you would likely to be, you would rather believe that it is true in general. Similarly, the second rule is more like saying that the world is not a bad place, so which says that if you know someone, if you knows V, then you also likes V. Again, there is a weight. So this is the example that we'll use. Given some constraints, for example, I could instantiate this formula with these constraints. So X, U are Anna, Y, V is Bob, and Z is Mary. So given these constraints, I could create this ground formula. So this is just one ground formula, but in general, you would try all possible substitutions and create the corresponding ground formulas. And each of the ground formula share the weight with the original first order logic theory. Okay, so given this, you may ask, what is, how do you define the distribution? This is the standard graphical model or Markov network distribution. It might look scary, but it is not a very complicated expression. It is simply exponentiated sum of weighted feature functions. So there is a feature Fij for jth grounding of the ith formula. So if you look at the two sums, so I am summing over all first order logic formulas, that is I from 1 to n, and for every first order logic formula, I am going over all possible groundings of that formula, that is j from 1 to mi. Z is a normalization constant, and the probability that I define is for a particular assignment, true or false assignment to all the ground atoms in the theory. So this is the distribution that we have, and very simple transformation can show that equivalently I can write this as a product of potential functions phi ij's, where there is one-to-one correspondence between feature functions fij and phi ij. So we'll use the one on the lower part of this slide for the rest of this talk, right? And z is the normalization constant as before. So given this, what is the task that we are interested in is called the marginal map inference. So I define the marginal map objective, which takes the original expression, the probability distribution, and I sum over. So I should mention that we divide the set of predicates into what we call as max predicates, over which we want to maximize, and sum predicates S, right? So this is simply taking the distribution and summing over the sum, the assignment to the sum predicate groundings, and then this is a function over the Q groundings. And what we are interested in is maximizing over Q, right? So you sum over the sum predicate groundings, and then find out what is the best possible assignment to the Q variables. Note that I've gotten rid of Z because it's a normalization constant, and as far as finding the argmax is concerned, it does not really matter what that Z is, so I can get rid of that. It's a fairly hard problem because the sum and the max don't commute with each other, so it is well known that this is harder than the marginal and the map inference. Now the question that we would like to answer in this talk is, can we exploit lifting or symmetries to solve this problem much more efficiently? Okay, before I go to the main part of the talk, let me give you one more slide of background. Here I'm defining equivalence relationship between variables. So this is, right, what we do is, given the variables in our theory, we say that two variables are related by this tilde relationship if they appear at the same predicate position. Or because it's equivalence relationship, if there is another variable Z, which is related to both X and Y, then X and Y are also related. Intuitively, what we want to say is that all the variables which are in the same equivalence class share the domain, right? So you would like to really work with them together with these equivalence classes. The example that we had here, the equivalence classes are X, Y, V, because Y appears as the second argument of nose predicate, and V also occurs as the second argument of nose predicate. Similarly, Z and U. So we have these three equivalence classes, and all the transformations that we will do will be over these equivalence classes. Okay, so now coming to the first part of our contribution, which is exploiting the extrema property. So here is sort of, before I go to exploiting the property, let me define what we mean by extreme assignments. So extreme assignments are defined with respect to some equivalence class variables. For example, if we consider YV, so here we are saying that an assignment is an extreme assignment with respect to equivalence class YV if the following holds: that consider all possible groundings in your state where the instantiations of the equivalence class variables vary, but other variables are instantiated to the same constant. For example, here, no ZY, I fix Z to Z1, but Y is varying, right? If all these groundings where only the equivalence class variables vary, they get the same truth value, true or false, right? If they get the same assignment in your state, then I say this is an extreme assignment with respect to this equivalence class. And this will be the key property that we'll use to essentially exploit lifting or symmetries. Okay, so this is just the formal definition. I'll skip this, but you can go back to the paper. I think I explained it already. Okay, so here is the intuition of what we are trying to do. So this is the same theory that we had. I've just omitted the weights for not to make the slide cumbersome, but the weights are still there. So think of these two formulas and YV, because they belong to the same domain. Let's say the domain is Y1, Y2, YK up to YM. So given this domain, what we can do is that we can sort of divide our groundings into this M sort of partitions, where each partition corresponds to those groundings where Y is instantiated to, let's say, YK. So the first partition corresponds to Y1 and Y2 and YK and so on up to YM. So given these partitions, there are a few remarks or few notes that I want to make. One is that all these problems or sets of groundings are identical to each other up to renaming, right? For example, if I rename y1 to yk or ym, I get another partition. Second, that note that they are not independent of each other. In particular, note that parent zx, which does not contain an equivalence class variable, is shared across these partitions, which means that if they were independent, then the task would be very easy. In fact, some of the earlier literature has exploited this independence property, but for many problems, they are not independent, and we would still like to exploit symmetries. Third is something that we would like to exploit, is we would like to say that is there a one-to-one correspondence between solutions to these sort of subproblems? In particular, the question that we would like to answer is, can we work with one of these theories, find the solution, and sort of replicate it across different theories? Right? For example, if I could say that no ZY1 has the same value as no ZY2, no ZY3, and so on in the final assignment, then which essentially means that if no ZY is at extreme with respect to the equivalence class, then I could exploit this fact to solve one of the theories and get the solution. So this is the core idea. I should also mention that we had an earlier paper at NIPS a few years back where we exploited a similar structure for MAP inference where there is no sum variables, but now we want to do something similar for marginal MAP, which is a significantly harder task because of the presence of the sum variables. Okay, so to do this, I define something, a particular kind of equivalence class, which is called SOM, single occurrence for max. So this has two properties. The first property says that my equivalence class variables should appear at most once in every formula, and that is very critical or very important for assignment being extreme. And the second one is that the variables should occur at least in one map predicate or one max predicate. Here is an example, the same example that I have. If I look at the class YV, then it is easy to see that it is SOM. Why? Because the first formula only has occurrence of Y and the second formula only has occurrence of V, right? So this is singly occurring. And also this class occurs in max predicates. For example, it occurs in nose, right? So here the sum predicate is parent and the remaining are max predicates. So nose, ZY, so Y occurs in the max predicate, therefore it is SOM, right? And this is sort of our main result in the paper, which says that that for SOM equivalence class, the solution lies at extreme. So, right, which is a very nice property. Why? Because the corollary is that for extreme assignment, since we know the solution is at extreme, instead of searching through the entire space, I could actually look at only the extreme assignments, which reduces the search space quite a bit, and essentially get to the same solution. So this is the main idea or main part, main one of the main theorems of the paper. Okay, so proof sketch, again the proof is fairly involved. Let me highlight one or two key steps. So this is the map, marginal map objective that we had, and there are a bunch of transformations that we do over this, but there is one transformation that I would like to highlight, which is, we are given that the equivalence class is SOM, we are able to interchange this product and the sum, which is the key step, and this is called inversion elimination that people have discovered earlier in the lifted inference literature. Once we do that, then the sum goes inside, and that sum can be computed efficiently, and once we do that, we get a simpler expression over which exploit symmetries, and there is another convexity argument that we have to make to show that the solution actually lies at extreme, right? So this is, again, there are much more details where I will encourage you to look at the paper, but once we prove this, then we can show that for SOM equivalence class, the solution lies at extreme. Okay. So good, right? So we have established the first fact that for certain equivalence classes, the solution lies at extreme. But now we would like to say, can we exploit that to actually compute your inference or do your inference faster? Now the question is it true that if your equivalence class is SOM, then can you actually make your inference faster? And unfortunately, the answer is no. Or I should say that it is open, at least we could not prove. But what happens here is illustrated by this picture, that we have this nice class SOM, this equivalence class of variables, but we also define another equivalence class which is called SOM R, which is a subset of this equivalence class, and we show that if your variable belongs to SOM R, then not only the assignment is at extreme, but you can also exploit it for efficient inference, right? So this is the second main idea of the paper. Right? And what is this SOAM R class? This is very simple. These are those equivalence class variables which are SOAM, right? So those conditions have to be satisfied. Additionally, we have a condition that all the SOAM predicates, either all of them should have your SOAM equivalence class variables in them, or none of them should have, right? So if this condition is satisfied for your SOAM predicates, then we call it SOAM R. And we can show that for SOAM R, the complexity of inference can be reduced by actually solving it for a single constant. I will come to that, right? So here is again the same example. YV was SOAM equivalence class. I showed that, but it is also SOAM R. Why? Because there is single SOAM predicate parent which does not contain Y or V, right? So the SOAM predicates do not contain the equivalence class variables. Therefore, it is SOAM R, which means I can actually apply my reduction over this theory and compute, do my inference in a much faster fashion. Okay. So this is the second main theorem of the paper, which is lifted inference rule for marginal map, which says that domain of SOAM R variables can be reduced to a single constant for solving marginal map, right? Which is very nice, because it says that, as many of us know, that inference complexity can be sort of exponential in the size of your groundings. But here we are saying that your theory size does not depend at all on your domain size, because you can reduce the domain size to a single constant as far as your equivalence classes SOAM R. Right? In terms of, again, our example, what happens? We have this theory, and because YV was a SOAM R equivalence class, so I can replace all the instantiations of YR by Y1, right? Some constant in the domain, read up the solution to this theory and replicate it for the remaining theory, and I actually get the solution, right? So which is very nice, right? So this is our main sort of lifting rule for SOAM R. Proof sketch, again, I will not go in detail, you can look at the paper, but it involves some kind of monotonicity arguments and correspondence between the solutions of the reduced theory and the original theory, and we show that the relationship between the reduced theory and the original theory objectives is monotonic, which lets us prove that the result is correct. So let me come to experiments now in the remaining time. So we experimented with three different approaches. The first one is called the ground inference, that is simply taking the theory and grounding it and applying a Bayes solver. The second is lifted basic. So lifted basic is applying existing lifting rules, right? So there have been some existing lifting rules which people have proposed, for example, binomial and decomposer. So we compare, how well do they do compared to the ground inference, and lifted SOAM R, which takes R SOAM R lifting rule and combines it with binomial and decomposer and applies all of them together. And we want to compare three different approaches, how well do they do. How well do they perform on the data set that we experiment on. I should make a remark that it's more like a pre-processing idea, that we take the theory, reduce it using one of the lifting algorithms, and then finally apply a Bayes solver. Okay, three benchmark Markov logic domains that we experimented on. The first one is the student domain, there is friend and smokers, there is IMDb, all these are standard benchmark domains. I'll describe them very soon. Two metrics that we compared on time and memory, and we use the Bayes solver, which is by Radu Marinescu, which was proposed back in 2014. So here is the student data set, right? So it has a single rule, and there are unaries for each of the predicates, which may have negative weights. So here, takes and job offer are max predicates, and teaches is a SOAM predicate, right? So you want to find the maximizing assignment of takes and job offer. We don't really care who teaches which course. We want to sum over it. And the blue curve, right? So there are three curves. The green one is the ground one. The orange one is lifted, and the blue one is lifted SOAM R. So clearly, you can see and both the y-axis in both the graphs are on log scale, right? So clearly you can see that our algorithm leads to almost constant time performance in terms of time, and the other two algorithms, lifted basic actually does not give any advantage compared to the ground inference, so they are identical. And in terms of memory also, we scale much better compared to the other two algorithms. Friend and smokers, it is interesting now that for this domain, lifted basic and our approach actually perform identical, which means that lifted SOAM R is not helping, but still we can do as well as existing algorithms, and ground does much worse, both in terms of time and memory. For IMDb, This is about movies and you know, directors and actors and who works with whom. Here, the blue curve is better than the green and the orange. And the orange is actually slightly worse than green, and I can talk about it, why this is happening in this manner. But there is some overhead in the beginning. We perform slightly worse in the beginning, but for larger domains, we are significantly better. Okay, so I think I'm almost out of time. Let me conclude. This is the final slide that I've presented, two key ideas. I have presented first lifting algorithm for marginal map inference. Future work, there are multiple directions. One is approximate lifting. Can we do lifting approximately? Can we handle evidence? One thing I did not say explicitly was that we assume that there is no evidence, but there is some ongoing work that we're thinking about how to handle evidence. And finally, which is more general, not applicable specifically to this problem, is how do we apply these techniques for combining with deep learning, where there is a CRF sitting at the end of the deep learning model. Okay, thanks.